From the studios of Books in Motion in Spokane, Washington, this is Gene Engene reading Casca, The Damned by Barry Sadler. We'll begin with the prologue. Casca listened to the slapping of the waves against the hull of the ship, the flapping of the single sail in the shallow breeze, which was taking him away from the past. On to what? He stayed in the shade as much as possible to keep the sun off his still tender skin, and placed himself where he could catch some of the breeze pushing them forward. He was so damned tired. Nothing had changed for him. Nothing he ever tried ever made any difference. The future was the same as the past, only the names changed. He grimaced when an edge of a plank dug into his ribs. To ease the pressure, he sat back, hands wrapped around his knees, looking across the easy rolling waves to Syria, where he had boarded ship at Antioch. Beyond, behind the mountains and deserts, lay Persia, the empire of the Sassanid kings and personal domain of Shapur II, king of kings. Persia. The name brought a bitter taste to his mouth. The sleeves of his burnous fell back when he moved his hand to push away a droning fly. Red welts exposed themselves to the sun. He pulled the sleeve back down. Under the flowing robes, his entire body was much the same, a mass of seared, burned tissue, a gift from Shapur to repay him for his loyalty and service. He still found it difficult to sit near an open fire without wanting to scream. The smell of roasting meat made his stomach turn, for it had not been long ago that he had smelled his own roasting flesh. Of all the pain he had ever known, nothing was as bad as those minutes on the stake where the fires ate at his body. Flames washing his flesh, sizzling, cracking the skin open to expose raw red meat to their searing touch. He shivered uncontrollably, his skin rippling in remembrance. What was it Samuel the merchant had said to him the first day he set foot inside the walls of Neve Shapur, that Persia was not for the likes of him? He had snorted bitterly then, for where was there a place for such as he? Never had he found anywhere he could call home for more than a few years. Always time drove him out to somewhere else he didn't belong. It had taken nearly a month from the time he had left the cave near Koramshar till he saw the distant wavering outlines of the first Roman outpost through the shimmering waves of ground heat. Colonnesium. Cresting a rise, he had stopped before going down. Two names came to him as he'd looked back on the plains and valleys behind him, that of the man who had given him both glory and pain, Shapur II, king of kings, Shahashan-ut-Anaran, the glory of Ahura Mazda, whose symbol was the ever-burning purity of the sun. When a petitioner would approach his master, he would do so on his knees, hands covering his eyes, crying out, "Lord, I am blinded by your radiance." For to all in Persia, Shapur was the sun, by whose will fields would grow or cities would die. Shapur was the instrument and personification of their god. Casca's reward for years of loyal service, fighting the wars of Persia to secure the frontiers threatened by savage tribes, was to be proclaimed a heretic by the vizier Rashid, and put to the stake to have his body burned to ashes. That Shapur had believed Rashid still pissed him off. But then the favor of kings is a fickle thing at best, and if they wanted to burn someone at the stake, it didn't require much reason to do so. The other name was that of Imhept, the Egyptian, who had taken him from the burning stake before his body was completely consumed. Imhept had nursed him back to health in the cave by the sea, then provided him with the money he needed to get free of the lands of Persia. If he were found alive in Shapur's domains, it would mean a return trip to the stakes. Imhept had only been able to free him by claiming a debt owed him by the king that had been made in public. He had forced Shapur to live up to his word when he had promised to grant Imhept anything within his power. Imhept had chosen Casca. The fly returned to buzz around his nose, and though the little pest didn't touch his skin, the buzzing of the wings, millimeters from the hairs of his nostrils, made him feel like sneezing. He brushed the mindless creature away with the back of his right hand. He didn't think that Shapur would have let the Egyptian claim him if he hadn't believed him to be already dead. He wished the little man of the Nile well. He turned from his reflections to face the dim walls of Colonnesium. It would be dark before he reached them. That meant he would spend one more night sleeping in the open. He longed for a warm bath and oils to ease the aches of his body and soothe the innumerable sore spots where the leather of his sandals or even the rough threads in the inner seams of his tunic irritated sensitive skin. He walked down the path leading to the gates, taking his time. He nearly laughed at the thought of taking his time. For what did time mean to a man who was damned? Time only meant that he would go on to face more disappointments, more pain, and always more killing, years and tens of years into the unforeseeable future, where he would never be given the peace of death. He sat by the gates along with about a dozen others who were waiting for dawn when the gates would open. He kept apart, staying to himself with knees pulled up to his chest and his robe wrapped tightly about him to keep out the chill of the night. He didn't sleep that night. There were too many thoughts pulling at him to give him any rest. Casca looked to the west where a dim line of gray was beginning to show. The rest of those waiting went about their morning ablutions, finding quiet spots to ease their bladders and bowels. Those that had women with them had built small fires, fed by camel and horse chips, and were warming food. His stomach gurgled, reminding him that he hadn't eaten since the previous day. From his pack, a small bundle of dates and olives served as breakfast. He could hear the changing of the guard on the town walls, familiar orders that he had obeyed more than once. It gave him a feeling of comfort to hear the language of Rome, his native land, again after so many years away, from the Great Wall of China to the frontiers of Persia. How many leagues had he ridden and marched, fighting one battle after another, and for what? He fell in line behind a Syrian farmer pulling a reluctant donkey loaded down with grain sacks larger than the animal was. The sun appeared over the ridge he had crossed the previous day, sending single red beams of light sliding across the plains to strike the brick walls of Colonnesium at the same time the gates were unbarred and swung open. When he entered the walls, the guards gave him a cursory once-over. One of them pulled his hood back to get a closer look at the face in the shadows. He wished he hadn't. The exposed face had red welts covering the right side, and the skull was devoid of hair except for a few stubborn patches that were beginning to grow through the red welts. Even with his amazing powers of healing, it would be some time yet before he had a face that wouldn't turn goat's milk into cheese. But he knew the scars would eventually be sloughed off like a snake skin as the new tissue under them pushed up to the surface. The sentries could see the burns continue down from his neck to his chest under the loose robes. One of the guards started to take the pack containing his sword from him, but changed his mind when the gray-blue eyes, staring out from a skull face, locked on his. He had no desire to inspect Casca further. Colonnesium was much the same as any of its counterparts in Persia. The only difference was that the tongue of the Roman Empire was heard more frequently. And
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.